Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Civil War of 1812, American Citizens, British Subjects, Irish Rebels, and Indian Allies, by Alan Taylor, narrated by Andrew Garman.
Introduction. A quote from An American Farmer, 1813. As much as the people of the two nations resemble each other in face, it's notoriously evident that there are some in America whose souls are perfectly British, and it's believed that there are some in Britain who are Americans at heart. It's not where a man was born or what he looks like, but what he thinks which ought at this day to constitute the difference between an American citizen and a British subject. In the fall of 1812, Ned Myers, 19 years old, marched across New York State with a party of fellow sailors bound for Lake Ontario, where the American Navy was building warships for an invasion of British Canada. But Myers felt the enemy long before he reached the Canadian border. In northern New York, the sailors came to a village where the inhabitants bitterly opposed the war. On a trumped-up charge, the villagers arrested the officers in command of Myers' party, but then had to release them when the sailors threatened to burn the village. Moving on to Oswego Falls, the sailors got caught in a downpour and sought refuge for the night in a large barn. That night, as Myers recalled, they caught the owner coming about with a lantern to set fire to the barn, and we carried him down to a boat and lashed him there until morning, letting the rain wash all the combustible matter out of him. In the War of 1812, Myers had to fight against Americans as well as Britons. During the following summer on Lake Ontario, a British warship captured the schooner that Myers served on. As a prisoner, Myers dreaded the discovery of his secret, that he had been born a British subject in Quebec in 1793. Abandoned by his father, a German officer serving in the British Army, Myers had grown up in Halifax, the capital of Nova Scotia, another British colony. At age 11, he had run away to New York City to become a sailor. Rejecting his birthright as a British subject, Myers chose to become an American citizen. America was and ever has been the country of my choice, and while yet a child, I may say, I decided for myself to sail under the American flag, and if my father had a right to make an Englishman of me by taking service under the English crown, I think I had a right to make myself what I pleased when he left me. But the British insisted that every natural-born subject remain so for life. Before the war, Myers had repeatedly and narrowly dodged the Royal Navy press gangs, which stopped and boarded American ships in search of any mariner who seemed British. And once the war began, British officers treated former subjects as traitors if they were captured while fighting in the American service. As a British prisoner, Myers feared for his life. In September at Quebec, a press gang boarded his prison ship to seize Myers and seven other prisoners. Myers insisted that five of them were Americans by birth, but a British naval officer pronounced us all Englishmen, obliged to serve in the Royal Navy or face trial and hanging as traitors. All eight refused to serve on a warship, but consented to work on an unarmed transport vessel. They sailed for Bermuda, where naval officers again impressed them to serve on a warship, which threatened to swallow us all in the enormous maw of the British Navy. Refusing again, the captives hazarded a court-martial. Unable to prove that the sailors were subjects, the British transferred them to a prison at Halifax, where Myers worried that the locals would remember and recognize him. The War of 1812 pivoted on the contentious boundary between the king's subject and the republic's citizen. In the republic, an immigrant chose citizenship, in stark contrast to a British subject whose status remained defined by birth. That distinction derived from the American Revolution, when the rebelling colonists became republican citizens by rejecting their past as subjects. An immigrant reenacted that revolution by seeking citizenship and forsaking the status of a monarch's subject. But the British denied that the Americans could convert a subject into a citizen by naturalization. By seizing supposed subjects from merchant ships, the Royal Navy threatened to reduce American sailors and commerce to a quasi-colonial status, for every British impressment was an act of counter-revolution. By resisting impressment and declaring war, the Americans defended their revolution. War raised the stakes in the conflict over subjects and citizens. By converting prisoners or hanging a few as deserters, the British bolstered their contention that any natural-born subject owed allegiance for life, no matter where he went or what nation pretended to naturalize him. Returning the favor, the Republic's officers sought to entice captive Britons to enter the American service, thereby reenacting the revolution on an individual scale. Because the line between citizen and subject was so contested, rival commanders promoted the desertion of enemy soldiers, the defection of prisoners, and the subversion of civilians in occupied regions. As much as on any battlefield, the British and the Americans waged the War of 1812 in the hearts and minds of Ned Myers and his fellow soldiers and sailors on both sides. Revolution. In the American Revolution, the victorious patriots forsook the mixed constitution of Great Britain, where a monarch and aristocrats dominated the common people, then the norm throughout the world. In a radical gamble, the patriots created a republic premised on the sovereignty of the collective people, rather than of a monarch and his parliament. Meant to protect and promote the liberty, property, and social mobility of ordinary white men, the republic bred a suspicion of government's power as a tool for aristocrats to live as parasites on the labor of the people. But that republic for white men hastened the dispossession of Indians and prolonged the enslavement of African Americans in the southern states. And the British despised the new republic as a dangerous folly, for they celebrated their mixed constitution as more stable, just, and powerful. Where Americans sought to disperse and reduce the power of government, the British sustained an empire with the coercive energy to regulate liberty, particularly that of their colonists and the sailors needed for the Royal Navy. After the Revolution, the British Empire and the American Republic remained uneasy neighbors in North America. In addition to spawning the Republic, the Revolution led the British to build a counter-revolutionary regime in Canada, beginning with 38,000 American Loyalists expelled by the Patriot victory. In Upper Canada, they developed a Loyalist America meant to set an example of superior stability and prosperity that eventually would entice the rebel Americans to forsake their Republican experiment. Loyalists didn't believe that their empire had permanently lost the fight against the Republican Revolution. Neither Britons nor Americans thought that their rival political systems could coexist for long on a shared continent. Britons predicted that the Republic inevitably would collapse into anarchy and civil war. Surely, repentant Americans would then beg for readmission into the empire. With equal conviction, Americans insisted that nature destined their republic to dominate the continent. Eventually, they predicted, the Canadians would join the United States by rejecting the artificial rule of a foreign empire. Created by the Revolution, the border between the republic and the empire seemed tenuous and temporary, destined to shift either north or south as one or the other regime collapsed. Paradoxically, until 1812, the parallel convictions of providential inevitability kept relations tense, but short of war. For why risk blood and treasure on an invasion when the rivals' collapse would come naturally in due time? Partisan divisions within the Republic helped to provoke the war. After 1801, the dominant Republican Party challenged the British maritime policies as a threat to American sovereignty. But the minority Federalist Party sympathized with Britain's global struggle against the French Empire, led by the despot Napoleon Bonaparte. The Federalists also despised the Republicans as demagogues who pandered to the common people by weakening the national government. By 1812, the Republicans believed that the Federalists in New England were conspiring with the British to break up the Union. And the Republicans accused the Loyalists in Canada of covertly assisting Indian attacks on frontier settlements. By invading Canada and defeating the British, the Republicans hoped to unite and save the Republic from a menacing convergence of internal and external enemies. Instead, the war alienated the Federalists, who preferred to smuggle with the British rather than to fight them. Civil War. Ned Myers fought in a civil war between kindred peoples, recently and incompletely divided by the Revolution. In September 1813, a British lieutenant, John LeCouter, visited an American army camp where he marveled upon meeting the enemy officers. Strange indeed did it appear to me to find so many names, familiar household words, as enemies. The very names of officers in our own army. How uncomfortably like a civil war. LeCouter bantered with an American officer just returned from shooting birds. Much pleasanter sport, isn't it, than shooting one's own kindred and language? The American replied, "Indeed, Lieutenant, it is so, I assure you. Believe me when I tell you it so grieves my heart to fire my guns on your people that I have asked leave to return to Virginia or to serve elsewhere." But a month later, an atrocity by American troops led LeCouter to denounce them as deserving no mercy in battle. "The rascals, they are worse than Frenchmen," so said the British officer with a French name. In July 1812, William K. Bell of Kentucky was a prisoner held by the British at Amherstburg in the Western District of Upper Canada. Bell was amused in contrasting the tavern signs with those in our country. Instead of Washington, Green and others might be seen George III, the Lion, the Crown, the King's Bakehouse, etc., etc. But the allegiance of people was less clear. Bell lodged at the Sign of the Harp of Erin, with a landlord named Boyle who had left Ireland for America, where he had served in the Republic's army during the early 1790s. Deserting to the British, he had settled at Amherstburg, but in 1812, Boyle fell under official suspicion for expressing sympathy for the Americans. Allegiance was slippery and suspect where so many people had crossed boundaries in geography and identity. Bell also met William Elliott, a former American officer from Maryland. A Federalist, Elliott had lost his commission in a Republican political purge in 1802. Disgusted with the Republic, Elliott moved to Upper Canada, where he swore allegiance to the king, which secured him land and appointment as a captain in the militia. Across the river at Detroit, one of Elliott's brothers served in the American army, poised to attack Amherstburg in 1812. In this North American Civil War, brother fought brother in a borderland of mixed peoples. At Kingston, LeCouter lodged with a Mrs. Elizabeth Robinson. "They are a Yankee family and have several relatives in the American Army and Navy." Another British officer, William Dunlop, reported that a Canadian soldier of the Glengarry Light Infantry shot an American rifleman and plundered his corpse when he discovered that it was his own brother, and coldly remarked that it served him right for fighting for the rebels when all the rest of his family fought for King George. Like so many on both sides, this Canadian thought of the war as continuing the revolutionary struggle between loyalists and rebels. Dunlop concluded, "Such is the virulence of political rancor that it can overcome all the ties of nature." As Myers found on his march to the front, the war also divided the Americans within the United States. Bell noted that the British depend more upon party divisions and disturbances among our people than they do on their own strength. Major Daniel McFarland, an Irish-American, insisted that the British were engaged in the hellish project of creating a civil war by promoting disaffection within the United States. The British exploited the polarized politics of the Republic, where Federalists denounced a war declared by the governing Republicans. A New Yorker concluded, "Between the two parties, a hostility existed little short of civil war." To call the War of 1812 a civil war now seems jarring because hindsight has distorted our perspective on the past. Given the later power and prosperity of the United States, we underestimate the fluid uncertainty of the post-revolutionary generation when the new republic was so precarious and so embattled. We also imagine that the revolution effected a clean break between Americans and Britons as distinct peoples. In fact, the republic and the empire competed for the allegiance of the peoples in North America, native, settler, and immigrant. Americans and Britons spoke the same language and conducted more trade with one another than with other nations. But their overlapping migrations and commerce generated the friction of competition. A British diplomat noted the paradox. The similarity of habits, language, and manners between the inhabitants of the two countries is productive of complaint and regret. The revolution had divided Americans by creating a new boundary between the victors in the United States and the Loyalists in Canada. And within the Republic, bitter partisan politics led the Republicans to cast the Federalists as crypto-Loyalists. In 1812, a newspaper writer explained that ideology, rather than nationality, distinguished the North American Republican from a Loyalist. As much as the people of the two nations resemble each other in face, it's notoriously evident that there are some in America whose souls are perfectly British, and it's believed that there are some in Britain who are Americans at heart. It's not where a man was born, or who he looks like, but what he thinks, which ought at this day to constitute the difference between an American citizen and a British subject. The ideological competition between the Republic and the Empire blurred the national boundaries and political identities in North America. After the Revolution, the overlap of Britons and Americans became more complicated, despite the new border in North America. Thousands of British emigrants poured into American seaports. Primarily from restive Ireland, the newcomers fled from British rule to seek economic opportunity and political liberty in the Republic. At the same time, from 1792 to 1812, about 30,000 Americans left the Republic to seek land in Upper Canada. Euphemistically called late Loyalists, these newcomers became the majority in that colony by the eve of war. Invited by the British to help develop Upper Canada, the settlers took an oath of allegiance and received grants of crown land, the prerogatives of subjects. In return, they were supposed to defend the colony against any American invasion. But if it was treason for natural-born subjects to fight against the empire, how could the regime expect natural-born citizens to fight against American invaders? By insisting that the subject was permanent, but the citizen fungible, the British asserted the superiority of their empire over the new republic. They implicitly treated Americans as residual or potential subjects, which hedged American independence. But that assertion of power masked the British weakness as a small island running a big empire, 125 times larger than their little homeland. In 1810, a Briton likened the empire to an oak planted in a flower pot. To defend that overstretched empire, the British desperately needed every subject who could serve in the British Army or Royal Navy. So they insisted on their right to reclaim any subject found on the high seas and to make subjects of foreign-born sailors and of American settlers in Canada. This double policy angered Americans hypersensitive to any erosion of their new independence. The two migration streams, of the Irish to America and the Americans to Canada, collided in the Civil War of 1812. Becoming staunch Republicans, the Irish Americans sought revenge on the Empire for dominating Ireland and for treating them as runaway subjects when found on American ships. Irish Americans served in disproportionate numbers in the armies that invaded Upper Canada, where they sought support from the late Loyalist majority. But that support withered as the American troops proved more adept at looting than at fighting. Defeat cast scores of Irish Americans into British prisons, where they had to enlist in the Royal Forces or face trial as traitors. To save them, the American government threatened to execute a captured Briton for every soldier hanged by the British. In an escalating spiral, most of the prisoners on both sides became hostages for the fate of the Irish American soldiers threatened with British trial. The Civil War had four overlapping dimensions. In the first, Loyalists and Americans battled for control of Upper Canada. Second, the bitter partisanship within the United States threatened to become a civil war, as many Federalists served the British as spies and smugglers, while their leaders in New England flirted with secession. Third, Irish Republicans waged a civil war within the British Empire, renewing in Canada the rebellion, which the British had suppressed in Ireland in 1798. Invading Canada, Irish American soldiers faced British regiments primarily recruited in Ireland, for thousands of Irishmen had fled from poverty by enlisting in the Royal Forces. Fourth, the war embroiled and divided native peoples. In the Great Lakes country, the Indians allied with the British to roll back American expansion. By intimidating and defeating the invaders, the native warriors obliged the Americans to seek their own Indian allies from reservations within the United States. The fighting especially divided the Shawnee and the Haudenosaunee nations. In the North American Civil War of 1812, Americans fought Americans, Irish battled Irish, and Indians attacked one another. They struggled to extend or to contain the republicanism spawned by the American Revolution. Histories. The War of 1812 looms small in American memory, forgotten as insignificant because it apparently ended as a draw that changed no boundary and no policy. At best, Americans barely recall the war for a handful of patriotic episodes, for the resistance of Fort McHenry to British bombardment, which inspired the national anthem, for the victories of the warship dubbed Old Ironsides, for the British perfidy in burning the White House and the Capitol, and for the payback taken by Andrew Jackson's Tennessee riflemen at the Battle of New Orleans. These images suggest a defensive triumph against British aggression, which obscures the war's origins and primacy as an American invasion of Canada. Of course, Canadians primarily remember what Americans forget, celebrating their victory as a David over the American Goliath, repelled after burning the public buildings of Upper Canada's capital. And Canadians cultivate their own patriotic icons, particularly the martyr Isaac Brock and the plucky Laura Secord, their equivalent of Paul Revere. But this book attempts a borderlands rather than a national history, for it promotes neither Canadian nor American icons of patriotism. A borderlands history examines the peoples on both sides of a new and artificial border, as they often defied the control of their rival governments. Neither a comprehensive nor a conventional history of the war, this book focuses on the contested region between Montreal on the east and Detroit to the west. In that borderland, two Great Lakes, Ontario and Erie, and three connecting rivers, the St. Lawrence, the Niagara, and the Detroit, served as the porous border between the Republic and the Empire. That border region featured most of the war's fighting and destruction. Focused there, this book pays only fleeting attention to the war's secondary theaters along the Atlantic and Gulf coasts and on the high seas. To compensate for the limited geographic range, I offer greater depth in time, devoting more attention to the roots of the conflict during the 1780s and the 1790s, and to the post-war consequences during the 1820s and the 1830s. Conventional histories dwell on presidents, diplomats, and generals, and on a few decisive battles which hinged in turn on the characters and intellects of those leading men, cast as either heroes or fools. Although I do narrate battles and do assess the feats and foibles of leaders, I devote more attention to the relationship of soldiers with civilians. For example, the plundering of York by American troops gets more play than does the brief battle that temporarily won that town, for the looting did far more to alienate Canadians than the victory did to impress them. To prevail in the war, both sides had to win the hearts and minds of civilians, both at home and on the front. Hampered by long supply lines, a short growing season, and sharp seasonal swings in temperature, the rival armies could only sporadically come to grips in battle. Commanders spent most of their time struggling to recruit, train, feed, clothe, motivate, and heal their soldiers, or to retake and punish those who ran away. To succeed, the commanders needed cooperation from the civilians who raised the food, provided the recruits, wove the cloth, and gave haven to deserters. To woo Upper Canadians, the American generals posed as liberators, but their men behaved too much like the ruthless plunderers described by British propaganda. On the other hand, the British had no better luck restraining their own troops or their Indian allies, who looted the Michigan Territory and the Niagara Valley, alienating the American civilians there. By telling the story of the Borderland War, I seek to illuminate the contrast and the contest between the Republic and the Empire in the wake of the Revolution. Both Republicans and Loyalists suspected that the continent was not big enough for their rival systems, Republic and mixed constitution. One or the other would have to prevail in the House divided. Like the Revolution, the War of 1812 was a civil war between competing visions of America, one still loyal to the Empire, and the other defined by its Republican revolution against that empire. But neither side would reap what it expected from the war. Frustrated in their fantasies of smashing the other, the Loyalist and the Republican Americans had to learn how to share the continent and to call coexistence victory. Chapter 1. Loyalists. A quote from Lord Dorchester, 1788. We are in daily expectation of seeing planters on the American side of the St. Lawrence River and Great Lakes, and it's much to be wished they should on all occasions perceive how much they are fallen, and the Loyalists find, upon every comparison, strong reasons to congratulate themselves upon having persevered in their duty. Despite the 1783 peace treaty ending the American Revolutionary War, a Cold War persisted between the United States and the British Empire. British officials regretted the treaty's new boundary through the Great Lakes as too generous to the United States and detrimental to Canadian security. They longed to shift that flawed boundary southward and to prevent the Americans from pushing northward to swallow Canada, driving the British from North America. In violation of the peace treaty, the British clung to frontier forts on the American side of the new border, and they supplied weapons and advice to Indian nations resisting the American expansion in the Ohio Valley. In 1791, at the height of the border tension and near its geographic center, the British established a new colony named Upper Canada. Carved out of the old province of Quebec, Upper Canada occupied the upper reaches of the St. Lawrence River and the northern shores of Lake Ontario and Lake Erie. Downstream belonged to Lower Canada, which retained the old capital at Quebec City, where a governor general held military command of both provinces. His subordinate, a lieutenant governor, exercised the executive power in Upper Canada. To serve as Upper Canada's first lieutenant governor, the imperial lords appointed Colonel John Graves Simcoe, who had commanded a regiment of loyalists during the war. Simcoe had friends in very high places, including Lord Grenville, the Secretary of State who made the appointment. Although recently elected to Parliament, Simcoe longed to govern the new colony, which he regarded as ideally positioned to revive the empire by sapping the republic. In 1789, he offered, "to consecrate myself to the service of Great Britain in that country, in preference to any situation of whatever emolument or dignity." In a gray drizzle on November 11, 1791, the British warship Triton ascended the St. Lawrence River to Quebec. The passengers included Simcoe, his wife Elizabeth, two children, and a handful of servants. Canada's capital and seaport, Quebec rose on a bluff, topped by stone walls with cannon to command the river. At the foot of the bluff lay the lower town, a compact grid of stone houses, shops, and warehouses beside the bustling wharves that hosted the ships. A steep street led up the bluff to the upper town, where a visitor found more houses, Catholic churches and convents, the governor's chateau, a marketplace, and barracks and a parade ground for the soldiers, all surrounded by the most impressive stone walls in Canada. The British clustered their Canadian troops at Quebec to guard the province's maritime gateway and to serve as a citadel should they lose control of the interior. In 1759, British troops had captured Quebec from the French, who conceded all of Canada to the victors in the Peace Treaty of 1763. To reconcile the French Canadians to British occupation, in 1774, Parliament adopted the Quebec Act, which endorsed French civil law and protected the Catholic faith. Parliament also dispensed with an elected assembly by mandating government by a military governor with a council of prominent colonists appointed by the Crown. The Act also extended Quebec's boundaries south to the Ohio River and west to the Mississippi. By pleasing the French Canadians, Parliament alienated the Empire's English-speaking Protestant colonists settled to the south along the Atlantic seaboard. In 1763, they had celebrated the conquest of Canada for freeing them from the Indian raids so long promoted by the French. The conquest also promised to open to colonial settlement and speculation the vast, fertile lands to the west in the Ohio Valley and along the shores of the Great Lakes. When the Quebec Act turned those lands over to a military regime based in Quebec, Americans feared confinement east of the Appalachian Mountains, within a boundary patrolled by savage warriors allied to the empire. That confinement seemed especially menacing because the British had begun to impose new taxes on the colonists, who resented the new levies as unconstitutional. The British sought the money to fund the garrisons needed for the enlarged empire, but the colonists feared a dire spiral of ever higher taxes that would impoverish them. The new taxes combined with the frontier restrictions to alarm the colonists that the empire threatened their status and prosperity as freehold farmers. In the Quebec Act, the Americans saw an arbitrary precedent ominous to their own freedom. As Protestants, they dreaded Catholicism as hostile to liberty and commerce. The provision of French civil law, rather than the English common law, troubled them by discounting trial by jury, freedom of the press, and immunity from arbitrary arrest. And by dispensing with an elected assembly, the Quebec Act aroused suspicions that the British soon would impose authoritarian rule on all of the colonies. In 1776, the American Declaration of Independence denounced the Quebec Act for abolishing the free system of English laws in a neighboring province, establishing therein an arbitrary government, and enlarging its boundaries so as to render it at once an example and fit instrument for introducing the same absolute rule into these colonies. In 1775, a Patriot Party seized power in the 13 colonies and sent troops north to drive the British from Canada. Although cool to the Patriot invasion, the French Canadians also did little to help the British defense. After capturing Montreal, the invasion ground to a halt before the walls of Quebec. In the pre-dawn of December 31st, a Patriot attack collapsed with the death of its commander, General Richard Montgomery, an Irish immigrant, while a loyal Irishman, Sir Guy Carleton, led the British defense. During the spring and summer of 1776, reinforcements arrived from Britain to drive the Patriots out of Canada and back into New York. Although unable to stage another invasion, the Patriots clung to their dream of ousting the British from Canada. Ratified in 1781, the original American federal constitution, the Articles of Confederation, pre-qualified the Canadian provinces as future states. A sense of weakness and a fear for the Republic's security fueled the lingering American longing for Canada. To frustrate that longing, Simcoe came in 1791 to develop Upper Canada into a powerhouse. Used to the mild and wet climate of England, the Simcoes had to adjust to the sharp and sudden swings in Canada's seasons. They arrived at the start of the long, snowy, and bitterly cold winter that locked up the rivers and lakes in ice, shutting down most business. But winter compensated with a festive social season, as the snow eased travel on skates or in sleighs for both pleasure and visiting. In winter, all is dance and festivity, one newcomer declared. After 4 months of dinners, plays, concerts, and balls, Elizabeth Simcoe exulted, "How happy I am!" Spring arrived in late April, when the melting snow and ice produced a slippery, muddy mess that paralyzed travel by land. After a brief spring, a surprisingly hot and humid summer came in a rush. By the 1st of June, we were in the midst of summer, a scorching sun, dusty roads, and the woods full of mosquitoes. Such is the sudden transition from winter to summer in Canada that there's no spring, a traveler marveled. As the ice melted in the St. Lawrence River, ships returned to Quebec, reviving business as the sudden rush of cargoes coming and going made for long and busy days through the brief warm season. That effect rippled upstream to the Great Lakes as boats carried British imports to upper country consumers. Farmers also had to work harder during the brief growing season between the frosts of May and September. In spring and summer, people had no time for socializing. On April 20th, Elizabeth Simcoe sulked, "I do not like relinquishing balls, concerts, suppers, and cards." The flow of information also alternated with the seasons. In summer, a ship took 2 months to carry news and goods from England to Quebec, and during the 6 months of winter, the Canadians lived without the news borne by arriving ships. Anxious for information, they welcomed April's burst of letters, newspapers, and travelers from Britain. A visitor remarked, "A Londoner can form no idea what a luxury a packet of papers from England is at Niagara when at the beginning of the spring, the communication is opened." He recalled Jonathan Swift's satirical account of a northern region where men's words, freezing at the commencement of a frost, were thawed at its dissolution into sounds, tumultuous and indistinct. In a dependent colony tethered to a powerful empire based in London, the Canadians longed to know the political and market news from Europe. Whether war or peace prevailed would affect their shipments, profits, and fates. A merchant in Canada begged his London supplier for communications. "From your side of the Atlantic, where every day events happen that are of importance to all the world, while in this remote corner, we are of importance to nobody but ourselves. Colonial officials particularly longed to know how they stood with their superiors in distant Britain. In June, a judge in Canada reminded an official in London, "Remember, October corresponds with April. Therefore, write speedily." Journey. In June 1792, the Simcoes and their entourage headed up the St. Lawrence River in three bateaux, flat-bottom boats, each about 24 feet long, able to carry 2 tons of cargo and requiring 4 men to row and a 5th to steer. As the working men rowed, the gentlemen and ladies examined the riverside landscape of whitewashed stone houses and wooden barns roofed with thatch. Every now and then, they could see wooden crosses, a gristmill, a Catholic church, or the manor house of a landlord known as a seigneur. Catholics of French descent, the people settled on long farms with a narrow frontage on the river. Britons regarded the French Canadians as ignorant, superstitious, lazy, and slovenly, but also as cheerful and vivacious. 5 days of rowing brought the travelers to Montreal, a middle-sized country town, by English standards, but solidly built of stone beside narrow streets. The crowding made fires frequent, contagious, and devastating, although the people had fortified their houses with slate or tin roofs and with iron shutters for their windows and doors. A visitor reported, "Every house looks like a prison." After a week at Montreal, the Simcoes resumed their journey by portaging in carts to Lachine above the rapids, where they returned to their bateaux for the hard ascent up the St. Lawrence for 180 miles to Lake Ontario, the first of the Great Lakes. Rowing hard against the powerful current, the boatmen made a slow headway of about 18 miles per day. They had to portage around 3 sets of rocky, foaming, and roaring rapids. Of course, their return trip downstream with the current was easy, cutting to 2 or 3 days the upriver journey of 10 days from Montreal to the lake. The time and labor of the ascent compounded the cost of getting British manufactured goods to consumers in the upper country. Above Montreal, the party crossed into Upper Canada, where the old French Canadian villages gave way to a thick forest broken by the new clearings of settlers. Passing the diminutive log houses surrounded with a few acres of cleared land, a visitor noted that a profusion of decayed and half-burnt timber lay around, and the serpentine roots of trees, blown down by tempests, stretched into the air in the most fantastic forms. With axes to fell the trees, oxen to haul them together, and fire to consume them, the settlers waged war on the surrounding forest. Piles of blazing timber sent forth columns of smoke, which enveloped the forests far and wide. Axes rung in every thicket, and the ear was occasionally startled by the crashing of trees falling to the ground. Elizabeth Simcoe delighted in the fiery spectacle. "Perhaps you have no idea of the pleasure of walking in a burning wood, but I found it so great that I think I shall have some wood set on fire for my evening walks." Some settlers killed the larger trees by girdling them, stripping away the lower bark, which left fields of leafless, graying, and rotting hulks. The settlers were Loyalist refugees, fleeing from defeat in the Revolution. Most came from New York's Mohawk Valley, where they had been the tenants or clients of the county's wealthiest and most powerful family, the Johnsons. When the rebellion erupted in 1775, the Johnsons stood by the empire that had enriched and empowered them. They rallied their settler clients and the Six Nations Haudenosaunee, or Iroquois, in a Loyalist coalition. Disarmed and harassed by patriots, the Johnsons and their tenants fled north to Canada, where they organized Loyalist regiments. Although averse to British taxation, the Loyalists regarded Patriot domination as far worse, as mob rule destructive to justice and property. While the Patriots fought for an independent republic, the Loyalists defended the union of the empire. Regarding Catholic and absolutist France as their traditional foe, the Loyalists understood the empire as a bastion of liberty, property, commerce, and Protestantism, values which they understood to be interdependent and fragile. Favoring a social hierarchy and a strong government, the Loyalists cherished the king and the aristocracy as essential elements in a mixed constitution designed to preserve order and property from anarchy. So they feared the Patriots as demagogues driven by greed and ambition to conspire against the freedoms best protected by the union of the empire and by the constitutional balance of king, aristocracy, and commons. The Loyalists felt vindicated when the Patriots brutally suppressed dissent and entered a military alliance with France. The Indians and the Loyalists fought hard and well, ravaging the Patriot settlements in the Mohawk Valley in 1780 and 1781. But in July 1782, they received demoralizing orders to stand down while British diplomats in Europe negotiated a peace with the United States. The new policy followed a crushing defeat at Yorktown, Virginia, in October 1781, when Lord Cornwallis had surrendered his British army to General George Washington. In 1783, the British concluded a peace treaty that recognized American independence and rewarded the Patriots with a remarkably generous boundary. Although financially bankrupt and defeated on the frontier, the United States secured expansive territory that stretched south to Florida, west to the Mississippi, and north to the Great Lakes. The new boundary sacrificed the empire's primary forts on the Great Lakes at Oswego, Niagara, Detroit, and Michilimackinac. The British Prime Minister, Lord Shelburne, paradoxically believed that indulging the United States with generous bounds would reunite the empire. He reasoned that, if diffused over a vast territory, the Americans would remain farmers, perpetuating their dependence on British manufactured goods. That economic dependence would profit British merchants and soften the American desire for political independence. Soon they would seek some form of renewed union with the empire. Shelburne argued, "If we are to look to regain the affection of America, to reunion in any shape or even to commerce and friendship, is it not of the last degree of consequence to retain every means to gratify America?" The treaty betrayed the people who had done the most to defend Canada, the Indians and the Loyalists. The Patriot diplomats pledged only to recommend that their states welcome back the Loyalists and restore their confiscated property. Everyone but the British negotiators knew that this recommendation was worthless, for the states meant to keep the property and to keep out the Loyalists. And in the weak American Confederation, Congress lacked the power to pressure the states. Embittered by wartime raids, the Patriots brutalized any Loyalist refugees who tried to return. In Albany, a public meeting resolved never to be at peace with those fiends, the refugees, whose thefts, murders, and treasons have filled the cup of woe. New York's governor, George Clinton, vowed that he would rather roast in hell to all eternity than show mercy to a damned Tory, an insulting name for a loyalist. Blocked from returning home, at least 38,000 loyalists settled in Britain's remaining northern colonies during 1783 and 1784. The great majority, 30,000, moved to the maritime provinces of New Brunswick and Nova Scotia. Smaller numbers settled in Quebec, 2,000, and the upper country, 6,000, west of Montreal as far as Detroit. In the upper country, the Loyalists clustered along the St. Lawrence River and around the Bay of Quinte, at the northeastern corner of Lake Ontario, or along the Niagara Peninsula at that lake's southwestern corner. To help the Loyalist settlers, the British Crown provided free land, seed grain, tools, and rations for their first 2 years. The government also built mills to grind their grain into flour and to turn logs into boards for building frame houses. In addition to rewarding loyalty, the British sought to strengthen Canada with people who would transform the forests into farms, which would reduce the costs of feeding the garrisons in the forts. Alienated from the Republic, the Loyalists could also provide a militia to help defend Canada should war resume with the Patriots. And the British hoped to score propaganda points by showing to Americans the benefits of clinging to the empire. Canada's Governor General, Lord Dorchester, insisted that they should on all occasions perceive how much they are fallen, and the Loyalists find, upon every comparison, strong reasons to congratulate themselves upon having persevered in their duty. During the late 1780s, the promise of the Loyalist settlements attracted a second pulse of emigrants from the United States. Many were friends and relatives of the initial immigrants. Others were Germans and Quakers from Pennsylvania and New Jersey. In addition to the pull of free land in Canada, the emigrants responded to the push of political turmoil and economic hard times in the United States. To pay their war debts, the American states levied heavier taxes than the British had ever dared to impose, which dismayed the common people. In welcoming the second wave, British officials adopted a broad definition of loyalism to include, in Lord Sydney's words, post-war sufferers under the ruinous and arbitrary laws and constitution of the United States. The British provided the newcomers with 200 acres of free land, but not the tools and provisions given to the original loyalists. The second wave helped to boost the population in the upper country from 6,000 in 1784 to 14,000 by 1791. In 1788, a parasite known as the Hessian fly devastated the wheat harvest in Canada and the American Northeast, producing rampant hunger during the spring and summer of 1789. On the American side of the border, most settlers muddled through with little or no help from the government. But Canadians benefited from a more paternalistic regime. New York was the lone American state to provide any public relief for the hungry. On the Canadian side, however, the storehouses of forts provided a reserve from which the commandants advanced barrels of pork, peas, and rice to the needy settlers. Still greater public relief came in the fall, when the Crown purchased in Britain and shipped to Quebec 1,000 tons of flour, 23,000 bushels of wheat, and 24,000 bushels of peas. Although the population of Canada was a third of New York's, the colony received 25 times as much public food relief. By delivering abundant food with a paternalistic flair, the British sought to strengthen loyalty in Canada. Lord Grenville assured Dorchester that the aid would impress the minds of His Majesty's subjects under your lordship's government with a just sense of His Majesty's paternal regard for the welfare of all his people. In 1791, the Crown canceled that debt with a flourish meant to contrast British benevolence with the crass commercialism of the Republic. Upon arriving in Canada, the King's son, Prince Edward, announced, "My father is not a merchant to deal in bread and ask payment for food granted for the relief of his loyal subjects." By contrast, in the Republic, the bread merchants ruled and imprinted their names on their towns. In the Mohawk Valley, the people renamed one town as Paris, not after the French metropolis, but to honor Isaac Paris, a merchant and miller who had loaned them food in 1789. The British promoted a Canadian identity framed in contrast with the Republic, understood as an amoral land of greedy competition where demagogues flattered the common folk but exploited the poor among them. Niagara. Upon reaching northeastern Lake Ontario, the Simcoes came to Kingston. Founded in 1784, Kingston had a small hilltop fort, barracks, an Anglican church, log wharves, and 50 wood frame houses. On a rocky point that sheltered the best harbor on the lake, Kingston prospered from the trade of the new farms that, during the 1780s, spread along the shores of the nearby Bay of Quinte. That bay also hosted Thayendanega, a small reserve occupied by a band of Mohawk Indians. Comprising one of the Haudenosaunee Six Nations, the Mohawks had fled from war-torn New York to join the British in Canada. To proceed up the country, the Simcoes had to cross Lake Ontario, for no roads penetrated the deep forest and no bridges crossed the many streams and rivers west of the Bay of Quinte. Rather than risk crossing the big lake in open bateaux, the Simcoes shifted into an 80-ton schooner, one of several vessels which sailed to Niagara, 160 miles to the southwest. Blessed with a fair wind, the Simcoes made the journey in just 3 days, but other voyagers battled headwinds for a week or more. The wooden vessels and the stormy lake made for a dangerous combination. Sudden and powerful storms generated great swells that could drive vessels against the shifting sandbars or the rocky cliffs on the southern shore. In November 1780, a blizzard sank the lake's largest ship, drowning 350 British soldiers and crew and their officers. Hastily built of green wood and poorly maintained, the lake vessels usually rotted to ruin within a decade. Worse still, the mariners were notoriously inept and chronically drunk. A Simcoe servant recognized one sailor as a chicken thief who had fled from justice in England. Another passenger recalled a harrowing passage through a night-long gale while the drunken captain bellowed, "Let us all go to hell together." Some travelers also swore that they saw a great snake at least 30 feet long, which, from its rearing its head and forepart out of the water, meant to attack them. On July 25th, the Simcoes reached the mouth of the Niagara River, which pours Lake Erie's water into Lake Ontario. On the eastern shore, Fort Niagara occupied a point that controlled the river's mouth and the harbor within. Built by the French during the 1720s, but captured by the British in 1759, Fort Niagara featured a stone stronghouse surrounded with extensive earthworks and a stockade to shelter the cannon that commanded the river. Beyond the walls and beside the river, crude taverns, stores, and bordellos sprouted on the bottom. A pious Quaker described Niagara as a strong fortification, but a dark, noisy, confused, dirty place. Across the river on the western bank, the British had built barracks, storehouses, and a wharf, where the schooners and ships disgorged their passengers and cargoes. That bank also had a new Loyalist village, Newark, which in 1792 consisted of about a dozen wooden houses on a grid of muddy streets. Eager to be on the front lines of a probable new conflict with the Americans, Simcoe made Newark his home and the capital for the new colony. Newark hosted a small elite of regular army officers, retired Loyalist commanders, and local merchants and magistrates, and their wives. Striving to maintain genteel standards in their frontier setting, they hosted dinners, levees, teas, card games, and balls. A traveler marveled at seeing the women wearing the feathers, trinkets, and all the paraphernalia of the haughty dames of Britain. While the fashions were British, this little high society included the daughters of Indian women and British officers. Elizabeth Simcoe enjoyed the pleasant society within a certain circle, defined by a gentility of means and manners. But she complained that the local servants were few, expensive, and uppity. "The worst of people do you a favor if they merely wash dishes for 20 shillings a month." In the upper country, the mosquitoes of summer carried an endemic malaria known from its symptoms as ague and fever. Associated with the lowlands, the sickness was more debilitating than deadly. But that sapping debility could last for months and came at the worst of times, during the short warm season when people most needed to work. Given the voracious labor demands of making a new farm in the forest, a family could ill afford the ague and fever. Unaware that mosquitoes carried the pathogens, people blamed their illness on night air around marshes or on drinking too much water in hot weather. From Newark, the new Loyalist settlements spread west on the fertile plain along the northern shore of the Niagara Peninsula. The new farms also stretched south along the west bank of the Niagara River to the celebrated falls, where the Niagara River pours over an immense escarpment, which extends over 200 miles from the Genesee River on the east to the western end of the Niagara Peninsula. A striking feature in an otherwise flat landscape, the escarpment became known as the Mountain. From Fort Niagara, the river extends 31 miles upstream to Lake Erie. Boats could ascend 7 miles to the rapids below the falls, where the boatmen had to portage for 8 miles to get over the escarpment. On the western side, the portage began at Queenston and terminated above the falls at Chippewa, where the boats could re-enter the river. While boatmen concentrated on their hard lugging, their genteel passengers exulted in the sublime spectacle of the largest waterfall they had ever seen, as a massive volume of water plunged 144 feet. Miles before reaching the falls, they could hear its thunder and see a thick cloud of mist. Elizabeth Simcoe noted, "The fall itself is the grandest sight imaginable, from the immense width of waters and the circular form of the Grand Fall." 16 miles above the falls, the boatmen reached Lake Erie. On the eastern shore, at the lake's outlet, they found Black Rock, a dark, low outcropping where Indians fished in the river. A few miles up the nearby Buffalo Creek lay a cluster of Indian villages, home to 2,100 natives in 1783. They spoke an Iroquoian language and belonged to the Haudenosaunee, or Six Nations Confederation, which consisted of the Mohawk, Oneida, Tuscarora, Onondaga, Cayuga, and Seneca nations. During the war, most had allied with the British and had fled to Buffalo Creek to escape Patriot raids on their villages. During the mid-1780s, the Mohawks founded another set of villages to the west in the nearby Grand River Valley. Proud of their victories in the war, the Haudenosaunee felt outraged by the shocking peace treaty, which cast their lands within the American boundary. In 1783, at Fort Niagara, a British general reported their insistence that the Indians were a free people subject to no power upon earth, that they were faithful allies of the King of England, but not his subjects, that he had no right whatever to grant away to the states of America their rights or properties. The Haudenosaunee wished to live as a free people between, rather than be divided by, the Republic and the Empire. In 1783, the 2,500,000 Americans greatly outnumbered the 100,000 British subjects in Canada. To even the odds in a renewed war with the Republic, the British needed Indian allies. After the loss of the 13 colonies, Patrick Murray explained, "We are no longer the first landed power in North America, therefore we cannot have too many Indians under our protection and countenance." The British had to treat the Indians with diplomatic respect and to bestow generous presents, including guns and ammunition. To keep the Americans away from their lands, the Indian nations of the Great Lakes and the Ohio Valley formed a confederation. During the 1780s, By defeating the American army and attacking the settlers in the Ohio Valley, the native Confederacy threatened the fragile American Union, which needed to expand to survive. Congress relied on the revenue and the patronage derived from selling the Indian lands north and west of the Ohio River. And new settlements provided farms for a rapidly growing American population. Already teetering on bankruptcy and hard-pressed to control the states, the Republic lost credibility as it lost battles to the Indians. To preserve their union, the Americans needed to defeat and dissolve the Indian Confederacy. While appalling to Americans, the Indian Confederacy appealed to Britons embarrassed by the peace treaty's betrayal of their native allies. Under Indian pressure, the British broke the peace treaty with the Americans by keeping the border forts along the Great Lakes. An Indian-controlled borderland also appealed to Canada's powerful merchants, primarily Scots, who traded British manufacturers for the furs garnered by Indian hunters around the Great Lakes. Retaining the British posts, defending an Indian borderland, and supporting an Indian Confederacy combined to keep away the meddling American traders and game-depleting settlers. By early 1784, Lord Shelburne's short-lived administration had fallen, and the new administration, led by William Pitt the Younger, recognized that the flawed peace treaty border compromised the security and economy of Canada. With growing signs that the American Confederation was faltering, the British also wanted to be in a strong position for the anticipated collapse. Seeking principled grounds for keeping the posts, the British cited the American violations of the peace treaty, for most of the states had frustrated British merchants from collecting pre-war debts and had kept the properties confiscated from the Loyalists. By retaining the border forts and arming the Indians, the British initiated a Cold War. Unwilling to recognize Indian initiative, Americans reflexively blamed their frontier troubles on malicious Britons, who allegedly manipulated ignorant savages in an insidious plot to confine and to subvert the Republic. Although outraged, the Americans felt helpless to break the British and Indian hold on the frontier. Nearly bankrupt, the American Union could afford an army of only 350 men, too few to fight the Indians, much less renew war on the empire. In 1785, the American Foreign Secretary, John Jay, sighed, "Our federal government is incompetent to its objects." Although willing to sustain a Cold War, the British hoped to avoid another expensive hot war with the Americans. By holding out the vague prospect that eventually they would surrender the forts, the British strung out diplomatic discussions with the Americans over the tangled issues of the border, the Indians, the merchants' debts, and the Loyalist property. Playing for time, the British waited to see if the United States would collapse, leaving the forts, the Indians, and the fur trade in the British orbit. The American diplomat John Adams explained, "They rely upon it, that we shall not raise an army to take the posts, and therefore they think they may play with us as long as they please." Detroit. Forested on both shores, Lake Erie was a passage between two isolated settlements, Niagara on the east and Detroit to the west, within an Indian world. Wearied by the stormy lake and the wild shores, travelers exulted on reaching the Detroit River, where the French Canadian habitant had crowded the banks with thriving farms. The valley boasted large orchards, which produced Canada's finest apples, pears, plums, peaches, and nectarines. In addition to orchards and farmhouses, the visitors could see thriving fields of wheat and peas, pastures for cattle, and an occasional Catholic chapel and several windmills which ground grain and cut logs. Beyond the narrow string of riverside farms loomed a dense and immense forest, which seemed disorienting and terrifying because it was so flat, so cloudy, so swampy, so devoid of landmarks for a newcomer, and so full of wolves and Indians. Delighted by the farms, travelers felt disappointed upon reaching Detroit, a cramped, noisy, and dirty town of 150 low houses, crowded within a palisade, punctuated by blockhouses. A fort loomed on the hill behind the town, while wharves covered the riverbank. Two carriages could barely pass in the narrow and muddy streets. The French-Canadian majority of artisans, boatmen, and laborers shared Detroit with British officers, Scots merchants, and the Loyalist settlers. During the day, Indians visited the town to trade and to drink. By 10 p.m., the soldiers shooed them out and closed the town gates, shutting in the inhabitants and shutting out the natives. Patrolling the walls and guarding the gates, sentries called out every 15 minutes and in succession, "All is well," with the last sentry concluding, "All is very well." Visitors found the nightly performance more unnerving than reassuring. The moral and pious Protestant sorts who kept travel journals also disliked the loose morals and abundant festivity of Detroit, especially in winter. A missionary concluded that the Detroit habitants were a thoughtless and wicked, a cheerful and good-natured people. That good nature certainly appears in their persistent hospitality to such censorious visitors. Polyglot Detroit represented the transformed British Empire of the late 18th century. During the Great Imperial War of 1754 through 1763, the British had won a more global and cosmopolitan empire, which included new sugar-producing islands in the Caribbean, slave stations in West Africa, much of India, and all of Canada. 20 years later, the American Revolution cost the British most of their overseas subjects who spoke English and who professed a British culture. Therefore, the British retained a disparate set of far-flung colonies, where English speakers were a small official elite governing diverse natives, enslaved Africans, or conquered French. With a new population of loyalists, most of the upper country of Canada was both an anomaly and a throwback to an empire where colonists claimed the rights of Britons. Empire. In the wake of the Revolution, the imperial lords struggled to define the best means to preserve the rest of their empire. To avert further revolution, British moderates favored libertarian reforms to appease their colonists. But conservatives believed that indulgence had lost the 13 colonies, so they favored an authoritarian paternalism that consolidated more power in the royal governors of the colonies. In June 1783, John Adams observed, "The British ministry and nation are in a very unsettled state. They find themselves in a new situation and have not digested any plan. Ireland is in a new situation. Canada, too, and Nova Scotia are in a new situation. The former, they say, must have a new government. But what form to give them, and indeed what kind of government they are capable of or would be agreeable to them, is uncertain." Ireland was linked to Canada, which in turn affected how the British would treat the newly independent Americans. Many Irish, both Protestant and Catholic, had identified with the American patriots during their revolution. Irish reformers shared the patriot critique of British rule as corrupt, irresponsible, and unresponsive. In 1775, the American Congress adopted an Address to the People of Ireland to promote Irish neutrality in the war and to offer emigrants a safe asylum from poverty and oppression. Irish popular songs celebrated patriot victories and treated General Richard Montgomery as a martyr for liberty. Irish mobs discouraged recruits for the British Army and harbored deserters from regiments ordered to embark for America. When the war diverted British troops to North America, Ireland became exposed to a French invasion. In 1778, Irish reformers pressured the British by organizing an armed militia known as the Volunteers, ostensibly to defend the island. Desperate for men, the British reluctantly accepted the volunteer units, which doubled as political clubs to agitate for reforms. That agitation seemed to triumph in 1782, when the Shelburne administration conceded legislative autonomy to the Irish Parliament. Thereafter, Ireland remained linked to Britain through the Crown, which appointed the Irish executive, a Lord Lieutenant, and his cabinet. Legislation by the Irish Parliament also still required the King's assent. By offering legislative independence but executive dependence, Shelburne hoped that this Irish constitutional reform would entice the Americans back into the empire. To his dismay, the Americans wanted no part of the Irish model, clinging instead to their new independence. Ireland's supposed legislative autonomy soon proved hollow. The Catholic majority remained barred from voting and from holding office. In partnership with the Lord Lieutenant, a small elite of Anglican aristocrats continued to dominate the Irish Parliament and to block further reforms. Rather than leading to greater autonomy, the limited concessions of 1782 proved a reactionary firewall that consolidated the recalcitrance of the Anglican elite, which deeply frustrated the Irish reformers. In 1782, Lord Shelburne had also sought to entice Americans by offering a generous commercial treaty. He proposed opening the empire's colonial ports to American merchant ships, restoring the pre-war trade which had been so mutually beneficial to American shippers and to the sugar planters of the British West Indies. But Shelburne's trade proposal appalled conservative Britons, who upheld the protective system mandated by the Navigation Acts. Framed during the 17th century, those acts favored British merchant ships at the expense of foreign carriers. That favoritism sought to increase British revenue, stimulate British shipbuilding, and maximize the number of British sailors. Those economic benefits sustained the powerful navy needed to protect the empire's commerce and to enforce the Navigation Acts against foreign interlopers. In a synergy, the Royal Navy secured the swelling commerce that generated the revenue and trained the sailors to sustain the fleet. British prosperity, pride, and power depended on preserving a maritime empire defined by the Navigation Acts. Conservatives insisted that, if rewarded with free trade, the cunning Americans would supplant the British as the leading carrier of the world's trade. The British would then lose sailors, their navy, and ultimately, their empire. Instead of indulging the dangerous Americans, the British should favor Canada's loyalists, who would prosper if freed from American competition by a privileged position to supply fish, livestock, lumber, and grain to the British West Indies. Lord Dorchester insisted, "The only firm hold that Great Britain has upon the remains of the American dominions is certainly by means of the Loyalists." In 1783, the British Conservatives benefited from the public backlash against Shelburne's peace treaty as appeasement to rebels. British taxpayers felt disgusted by news of American treaty violations, which obliged them to compensate the Loyalists for their losses. The backlash led the Crown to apply the navigation system to the Americans, which meant that only ships owned, built, and crewed by Britons or colonists could trade with the West Indies or carry away any colonial produce. American ships could trade at ports in Great Britain, for the British were eager to sell their manufactures to the American market. By enforcing the navigation system, the British provoked a commercial depression in the United States during the mid-1780s. Deprived of the West Indian market, American merchants could not pay their mounting debts for British imports. A wave of merchant bankruptcies and farm foreclosures created political turmoil. Unable to coordinate the trade policies of the states, and lacking the revenue for a navy, the Congress couldn't challenge the British terms of trade. and the American woes and weaknesses compounded British contempt for the Republican Union, which seemed doomed to collapse. In 1786, the British sent Lord Dorchester to Quebec as the Governor General. To serve as the colony's new Chief Justice, Dorchester brought along his American friend, William Smith Jr., who shared his vision for restoring the Union of the Empire. In colonial New York, Smith had been a leading lawyer, historian, and politician. A conservative patriot, he had opposed Parliament's taxes, but had cherished Britain's mixed constitution. Balking at independence and republican government, Smith had bolted to join the British in occupied New York City, where he served as a spymaster, political consultant, and jurist. Since the 1760s, Smith had promoted a constitutional rearrangement that would unite the colonies under their own parliament, independent of the British Parliament, but yoked to the empire by a crown-appointed Lord Lieutenant, as in Ireland. During the 1780s, the American turmoil confirmed Smith's conviction that no republic could survive on a continental scale. He confidently predicted, "We are on the eve of a revolution that will lay aside the Congress and the Republican models. The change will be either the setting up of the British model with a reunion or with a new king." To hasten that change, Smith and Dorchester proposed setting up a model constitution in Canada. By displaying the prosperous fruits of stability, the reformed empire would allure their American neighbors to abandon their futile experiment of an independent republic. Sooner rather than later, the Americans would need a king to restore order to their chaos. Leading Americans felt alarmed by the return of Lord Dorchester to Quebec with an apparent mandate to rebuild the empire in North America. It seemed more than coincidental that Dorchester and Smith arrived just as rural Massachusetts erupted in Shays' Rebellion, named for a disaffected army officer, Captain Daniel Shays. Hard-pressed to pay their debts and taxes, armed farmers shut down the courts and resisted state troops sent to suppress them. During the winter of 1786 to 1787, Shays and four of his officers visited Dorchester in Quebec, where rumors insisted that they pledged allegiance in return for munitions. Americans also worried over Dorchester's intrigues with the leading men in the frontier districts of Vermont and Kentucky. Anticipating a collapse of the American Union, Lord Grenville secretly advised Dorchester, "It appears extremely desirable that the turn of affairs in those settlements should lead to the establishment of a government distinct from that of the Atlantic states, and if that should be the case, every means should be taken to improve and cultivate a connection with the former, as being likely to prove highly advantageous to the interests of this country." But Grenville also warned Dorchester to avoid provoking war with the United States. Preferring to let the Republic unravel on its own, the imperial lords wanted to maximize their options without immediately committing themselves to any one of them. By flirting with Dorchester's agents, leading Vermonters and Kentuckians sought favorable trade deals and prepared their own contingency plans for the apparently impending collapse of the American Union. In early 1787, Dorchester sent his aide, Major George Beckwith, to New York City to gather information and to cultivate supporters for a reunion of the empire. During the war, Beckwith had served there as an intelligence officer running spies behind the Patriot lines. In his greatest coup, Beckwith helped to turn Benedict Arnold from a Patriot hero into the war's most infamous traitor. At war's end, Beckwith left behind a network of contacts that he reactivated during his post-war visit. In March, Beckwith arrived at the low ebb of the American experiment in Republican Union. New York's leading merchants and lawyers had lost confidence in the Confederation as impotent and in the state governments as prey to reckless demagogues. Alarmed by Shays' Rebellion, These conservatives longed for a stronger national government that could collect taxes, protect creditors, subordinate the states, and revive prosperity in the seaports. But they remained divided over the proper form for a stronger government. Would a reformed republic suffice? Or should they emulate Britain's mixed constitution with a king and aristocrats to regulate an elected legislature? Openly wearing his army uniform, Beckwith ostensibly visited to send Dorchester's dispatches to London via the port of New York. But he lingered, to the dismay of Republicans and to the delight of disaffected conservatives. His informants included such prominent men as Alexander Hamilton and his father-in-law, Philip Schuyler, who assured Beckwith that leading Americans longed for a king and for a reunion with the empire. At this moment, there is not a gentleman in the states from New Hampshire to Georgia who does not view the present government with contempt, who is not convinced of its inefficacy, and who is not desirous of changing it for a monarchy, Beckwith reported. They had found, from experience, that a republican system, however beautiful in theory, is not calculated for an extensive country. He added that some gentlemen planned covertly to visit London to propose that the British provide one of George III's younger sons, of the House of Hanover, to become an American king. Dorchester eagerly conveyed Beckwith's reports to the imperial lords in London. Although intrigued, they remained cautious, preferring to wait for, rather than hasten, the collapse of the Republic. Lord Sidney vaguely replied to Dorchester, "The report on an intention on the part of America to apply for a sovereign of the House of Hanover has been circulated here, and should an application of that nature be made, it will require a very nice consideration in what manner so important a subject should be treated." The imperial lords remained loath to make bold decisions, lest they backfire as embarrassing mistakes. Beckwith's informants expected little from the federal convention that met in Philadelphia during the summer of 1787. But, against long odds, the delegates crafted a new federal constitution to replace the Articles of Confederation, while retaining republican institutions, including an elected Congress. That constitution had the potential to provide a stronger national union that could subordinate the states. The new government could tax the people directly instead of begging requisitions from the states. And, unlike the Articles, the new constitution had a potentially powerful executive branch headed by a president. By October 1788, when Beckwith returned to New York for a new visit, 11 states had ratified the federal constitution, ensuring that the new government would commence in early 1789 with George Washington as the president. Beckwith's informants still preferred a mixed constitution, which Alexander Hamilton had, in vain, proposed to the Philadelphia Convention. But they reluctantly accepted the federal constitution as forming the most powerful government that the American public could abide. Of course, Beckwith saw any republican union as eventually doomed for want of energy sufficient to effect the ends for which it was framed. But he conceded the short-term possibility that the new government could muster just enough energy to raise an army to threaten the British border forts on the Great Lakes. Canada Act. The potential of the new American government obliged the imperial lords to resolve their own constitutional impasse in Quebec. If the Americans got their act together, the British would need greater cohesion and revenue to defend Canada. Under the Quebec Act of 1774, the Governor General and a council of British officials and French seigneurs governed without consulting the common habitants, who accepted political exclusion so long as they paid no taxes. The officials and seigneurs constituted a French party, which opposed any reforms as the slippery slope to a republican revolution. But the Quebec Act antagonized the colony's small minority of 2,000 Protestant Anglophones, primarily tradesmen and merchants who resided in the towns of Quebec and Montreal. This British party championed the British nationalism that upheld the Protestant faith, commercial enterprise, civil liberties, and an elected legislature as interdependent and essential to the wealth, power, and stability of the empire. Reinforced after the revolution by 8,000 Loyalist refugees, the British party pushed for English civil law, freehold land tenures, and an assembly. Their reforms would oblige the French Canadians to learn English, convert to Anglicanism, and become truly loyal subjects. Quebec presented a paradox wherein the British subjects felt restive because their own empire protected French culture and law. In his previous stint as Quebec's governor, from 1766 to 1778, Dorchester had championed the Quebec Act, but he subsequently shifted toward the British party position under Smith's influence. In the governing council, Smith acted as Dorchester's prime minister, enraging the French party, which derided the reformers as greedy merchants out to exploit the poor, who were said to prefer a paternalistic and authoritarian government. The two parties agreed that the proposed reforms would attract more American migrants to Canada. The British party insisted that the newcomers would weaken the United States and strengthen Canada with belated but sincere loyalists. Optimists of empire, they argued that the British mixed constitution appealed to Americans as they suffered from the folly of their republican experiment. By escaping from the chaotic states, the migrants could, in the words of Hugh Finley, once more enjoy a free government where the laws protect the person and property of the subject. The French party, however, distrusted immigrants from the land of rebellion as subversives who would foment a revolution in Canada. The conservatives preferred the Catholic French Canadians as the best barrier between our settlements and the United States. Evenly matched in the governing council, the British and French parties deadlocked in acrimony. Grown arrogant, cold, indecisive, and reclusive in his old age, Lord Dorchester provided little leadership. The squabbling dismayed the imperial lords. Dreading any popular agitation, the lords preferred a top-down solution imposed from London. In 1789, Lord Grenville explained, "I am persuaded that it is a point of true policy to make these concessions at a time when they may be received as a matter of favor, and when it is in our own power to regulate and direct the manner of applying them, rather than to wait till they shall be extorted from us by a necessity." Grenville drafted the Canada Constitutional Act, which Parliament passed in 1791. The act divided the immense old colony of Quebec into two new provinces, Upper Canada, along the Great Lakes, and Lower Canada, in the Lower St. Lawrence Valley, including the leading towns of Montreal and Quebec. The division was cultural as well as geographic, for Francophones predominated in Lower Canada, while English-speaking Loyalists prevailed in Upper Canada. The provinces shared a governor-general based in Quebec, but a lieutenant governor would administer the civil government in Upper Canada, and the two colonies had distinct legislatures. Canada's constitution reflected the lessons of the American Revolution as understood by its foes, who designed a government meant to avoid internal turmoil and to resist republican subversion. Grenville had examined the constitution of our former colonies in order that we may profit by our experience there and avoid, if possible, in the government of Canada, those defects which hastened the independence of our ancient possession in America. He blamed excessive colonial democracy because no care was taken to preserve a due mixture of the monarchical and aristocratical parts of the British constitutions. But Grenville also made concessions to head off popular discontent, for Upper Canada needed to attract and retain American settlers. The Constitutional Act mandated freehold land tenure in Upper Canada and dropped the crown quitrents that had irritated the pre-war colonists. these concessions followed Dorchester's advice, that all seeds of discord between Great Britain and her colonies may be prevented. In the Canadian provinces, settlers could obtain 200 acres by taking the oath of allegiance and paying merely nominal fees. One of the great ironies of the American Revolution was that it led to virtually free land for settlers in British Canada while rendering land more expensive in the United States. Burdened by public debts incurred to wage the war, the American federal and state governments sold lands to speculators who could immediately pay the large sums in cash desperately needed to satisfy the public creditors. For example, in 1791, the New York state government sold 5,542,170 acres to land speculators for $1,030,433. Those speculators profited by retailing the land to actual settlers, who had to pay a premium, usually $2 or $3 per acre. In sum, post-revolutionary settlers paid higher land prices to enrich the speculators who funded the war that had secured independence. If they disliked that bargain, settlers could immigrate to Canada to procure cheaper land by resuming their allegiance as British subjects. In a second major concession to American notions, the Constitutional Act reiterated Parliament's 1778 pledge never again to tax the North American colonists for revenue. Indeed, Britain heavily subsidized the government of Upper Canada by bearing the £50,000 annual cost for the military garrisons and the Indian presence. Parliament also funded the salaries drawn by the colony's executive and judicial officers at a further cost of £7,000 a year. By paying the executive salaries, the Crown ensured control over the colony. This arrangement reflected another British lesson drawn from the Revolution, that the elected assemblies of the 13 colonies had exploited their power over expenditures to intimidate Crown officials by threatening to withhold their salaries. By funding the executive and judicial establishments in Upper Canada, the British made a shrewd investment in colonial dependence and popular passivity. Because of this British largesse, the Canadian colonists paid minimal taxes, primarily to finance their elected assembly and to construct district courthouses, jails, bridges, and roads. In 1794, Upper Canada's landholders paid only 5 shillings in tax for every £100 in assessed property, a rate of 0.25%. This was 1/5 of the tax rate borne by New York's landholders. In 1808, the colony's revenue amounted to a paltry £3,000, about 5% of the total paid by British taxpayers to subsidize the colony. In another great irony of the Revolution, the winners saddled themselves with higher post-war taxes, as well as higher land prices, to finance their war debts. In 1800, an American emigrating to Upper Canada explained his push factor. "We fought 7 years to get rid of taxation, and now we are taxed more than ever." Although deemed the war's losers, the Loyalists in Upper Canada secured a lighter tax burden than that borne by either the pre-war colonists or the post-war citizens of the Republic. Grenville sought a less provocative revenue by reserving 1/7 of the public domain for the Crown. As settlement developed the adjoining lands, the Crown reserves would appreciate in value, generating enhanced rents to fund the government in lieu of taxes. Grenville believed that such a policy, if it had been adopted when the old colonies were first settled, would have retained them to this hour in obedience and loyalty. To endow the Anglican Church, another bond of loyalty, the British reserved another 1/7 of the public lands as clergy reserves. In a further concession to American expectations, the British provided each new province with an assembly elected by the owners of land. Grenville concluded that a restricted assembly would afford a juster and more effectual security against the growth of a republican or independent spirit than any which could be derived from a government more arbitrary in its form or principles. The British defined the assembly as a royal favor rather than as a popular right, and as the last, not the first, step toward a republic. Granville believed that the revolution had ripened in the 13 colonies because their assemblies had been too powerful and too democratic. Frequent elections from many paltry districts of small-minded farmers had filled those assemblies with parochial representatives hostile to imperial control. And so many representatives could not be co-opted given the limited patronage available to the colonial governors. Applying those lessons, the British limited the size of the Canadian assemblies by stretching the bounds of electoral districts. In Upper Canada, only 16 members represented the 19 counties in the first assembly of 1792 to 1796. The elected assembly also had to share power with a legislative council of colonial notables. Nominated by the lieutenant governor and appointed by the crown, the legislative councillors held life terms. Granville hoped, in the future, to bestow titles of provincial nobility on the most worthy councillors, to establish in the provinces a body of men having that motive of attachment to the existing form of government which arises from hereditary distinction. For want of a proper aristocracy, Granville reasoned, the old colonies had rebelled. Both houses of the legislature were constrained by a powerful executive branch that served at the crown's pay and pleasure. The lieutenant governor could summon, prorogue, or dissolve a legislative session. He appointed the speaker of the legislative council and could veto any speaker chosen by the assembly as well as any other bill. And his veto was complete, without provision for the legislature to override. Nor could the legislature review the measures or the expenditures of the executive branch. To become law, an assembly initiative had to survive a formidable gauntlet of increasingly elite and distant power. An assembly bill needed assent by the legislative council, next by the lieutenant governor, and finally by the imperial bureaucracy in London, where the crown had up to 2 years to veto a colonial law. By granting or withholding patronage, the lieutenant governor could manage a small legislature, for the members coveted commissions in the militia, or as justices of the peace, as well as contracts to supply the military garrisons with provisions. Of course, wayward representatives got nothing. In 1793, the province's chief justice advised John Graves Simcoe, "Grain is the sole produce of the country, and a market the only benefit required. Give me the control of that market, and I will ensure the result of every proposition to be made in the House of Assembly where every man is a farmer." Simcoe agreed that the provision contracts were indispensably necessary to carrying on of the public measures with facility and tranquility. Because the colony's farmers depended on the military market, the lieutenant governor possessed an economic and political power far beyond that of any royal governor in the 13 colonies. The mode of election also reduced popular influence in the assembly. The lieutenant governor appointed the sheriffs, who supervised the polling, held at a single location within each district, which kept down the turnout, given the dispersed settlements and miserable roads. Located in a shire town, the lone polling place favored voting by those most dependent upon the government's favor, the nearby lawyers, clerks, and merchants. Upper Canada also retained the traditional English practice of public oral voting, which discouraged independent voting by debtors and tenants. As in Britain, executive and judicial officers could also run for seats in the assembly, and they didn't need to reside in their districts. Better educated and more articulate than the farmer representatives, these officials dominated the legislative proceedings. During the 1790s, John White held an assembly seat, despite also serving as the Attorney General and as a district court judge. Although he lived at Newark, White represented a distant district at the other end of Lake Ontario. In contrast, the American state constitutions required legislators to reside in their districts and banned them from holding executive or judicial office. The large districts, single polling places, oral voting, and executive eligibility favored pro-government candidates. In 1792, Simcoe recruited his surveyor general, David W. Smith, to stand for an assembly seat in Essex County, which lay on the Detroit River, more than 200 miles west of Smith's residence at Newark. Simcoe explained, "The persons who shall compose the assemblies must admittedly be dealt with as our parliaments are, and be purchased to their duty by the participation of the officers of government." Smith entrusted electioneering to his wealthy friends, who campaigned in the traditional style by lavishing music, food, and alcohol, rather than policy discussions, upon the voters. A paternalist rather than an egalitarian, Smith advised his campaign manager, "Let the peasants have a fiddle, some beverage, and beef." Anticipating victory, he planned a culminating celebration. "I beg an ox be roasted whole on the common and a barrel of rum to be given to the mob to wash down the beef." As Simcoe expected, Smith won the seat and became the Speaker of the Assembly, where he zealously supported the Crown's policies rather than the parochial interests of his distant district. He explained, "We cannot at present exist without the assistance of Great Britain. She has ever shown herself a foster mother to her colonies, and any procedure which I conceive tends to divide the interests of the parent kingdom and her colonies, I will oppose with all my might." His perspective derived from his British birth and upbringing, his military officer's commission, his executive salary, and his loyalty to Simcoe, rather than from the dictates of his constituents. In 1795, a French traveler, the Duc de la Rochefoucauld-Liancourt, passed from the United States into Upper Canada. He marveled when Simcoe opened the legislative session, although only 5 of the 16 assembly members had arrived. "Where no taxes are to be settled, no accounts to be audited and examined, and no military regulations to be adjusted, public business cannot occupy much time. But if even all these points were to be discussed, the business would still be trifling, from want of an opposition, which seems to be precluded by the manner in which the two houses of Upper Canada are framed." Nothing could have differed more from the avid electioneering and hyperactive legislation that the Duke had witnessed in the United States. Constitutions. In sum, the governments of Lower Canada and Upper Canada were more elitist than the 13 colonies had been. Compared to their pre-war predecessors, officials in Canada were more dependent upon the Crown and less beholden to popular pressure. Indeed, the Canadian mixed constitution was a considerable reaction against the Republican experiments in the new United States, as a comparison with New York State reveals. Under the state constitution adopted in 1777, New York's elections became more frequent, more important, and more accessible to a larger electorate. The new constitution permitted polls in every township, rather than in just a single shire town per county, as under the old regime and the Canada Constitutional Act. In New York, written ballots also replaced the oral voting that had subjected common men to intimidation by their landlords and creditors. Because the colonial governor had been a royal appointee, who in turn had named the members of the upper house, New York's colonial voter could only elect representatives to the assembly. After the Revolution, however, most men could vote for governor, lieutenant governor, state senators, and federal congressmen, as well as for assembly representatives. The colonial system had allocated but 2 assembly seats for every county, no matter how large or small a county. The new state constitution established a more proportional system by allocating from 2 to 10 assembly seats per county, depending on population, and by mandating the regular addition and redistribution of county seats as population grew and shifted. New York's voters chose assemblymen every year, their congressmen biennially, their governor and lieutenant governor at triennial intervals, and their state senators every fourth year. Only the state senators were chosen as infrequently as Upper Canada's assemblymen. Republicanism maximized the popular sovereignty that the British mixed constitution sought to contain. The British designed the Canadian governments to avoid popular discontent and to discourage popular participation in politics. On the one hand, the British sought a content and inert public by minimizing taxation and the price of land. On the other hand, they also restricted electoral power to prevent demagogues from fomenting public ferment. Lord Thurlow explained that the British have given them more civil liberty without political liberty. He meant that they had granted liberties to Canadians while discouraging their political participation. In sum, the British worked to deny the colonists both the civil motives and the political means for rebellion. The Canada Constitutional Act culminated a decade of constitutional rearrangement in North America and Ireland. Set in motion by the American Revolution, the reordering included the 1782 reforms in Ireland, the Indian Confederacy on the frontier, a new federal constitution for the United States, and the creation of Upper and Lower Canada. All four were related. By blocking American expansion, the Indian Confederacy threatened the Republican Union that prospered by consuming Indian land. During the 1780s, Indian victories halted American expansion and land sales, revealing the impotence of the American Confederation. That impotence emboldened British leaders, who retained the border forts and revived the navigation system. The retention embarrassed the United States, while the revival inflicted a trade depression. In turn, the economic troubles increased social conflict, particularly Shays' Rebellion, which further corroded confidence in the Confederation. Dreading a drift to anarchy, many Americans began to fear, and some to welcome, a British design to subvert the Republic. Seeing an ominous precedent in the hollow reforms granted to Ireland in 1782, most Americans expected the worst from the similar scheme by Dorchester and Smith to render Canada a model for regenerating the empire. Americans feared the collapse of their weak union into an anarchy that would ultimately recommend a return to imperial rule. To save their Republican Union, in 1787 and 1788, the American Federalists crafted and ratified a new constitution. In response, the British endowed the Canadian colonies with a mixed constitution meant to attract American settlers while minimizing their political activity. Anglophone North America became a house divided between American republicanism and the British mixed constitution, and between American expansion and the resistance of an Indian Confederacy. Would the continent ultimately belong to an expansive republic, an empire of liberty, or to a renewed British Empire allied to a confederation of native peoples? To sway the answer to that question, the British sent John Grave Simcoe to govern Upper Canada. Chapter 2. Simcoe. A quote from William Dummer Powell, 1815. His head was filled with vast utopian projects, among which the least rational, and ultimately the most ruinous to the colony, was to restore the old British colonies to the empire and a persuasion that he was to be the instrument. Devoted to the empire and its mixed constitution, John Graves Simcoe bitterly mourned the loss of the 13 colonies. In 1791, he vowed, "I am one of those who know all the consequence of our late American dominions. I would die by more than Indian torture to restore my king and his family to their just inheritance." Determined to reverse the revolution, Simcoe believed that the new colony of Upper Canada could help to break up the fragile American Republic. He assured his superiors, It's in the hope of being instrumental to the reunion of the Empire, by sowing the seeds of a vigorous colony, that I prefer the station I am appointed to and its fair prospects to any post in His Majesty's dominions of whatever emolument. I'm persuaded that it's the interest of Northern America and Great Britain to be united in some mode or other, and that such an union is neither distant nor impracticable. Americans would sooner return to their proper allegiance if they could look north to see the fruits of a renewed empire in a prosperous and orderly Upper Canada. I mean to prepare for whatever convulsions may happen in the United States, and the method I propose is by establishing a free, honorable British government and a pure administration of its laws, which shall hold out to the solitary emigrant and to the several states advantages that the present form of American government doth not and cannot permit them to enjoy. Simcoe concluded, "The establishment of the British Constitution in this province offers the best method gradually to counteract and ultimately to destroy or disarm the American spirit of democratic subversion." He envisioned Upper Canada as an antidote to the revolution, as an alternative to the republic, and as the model for a revived empire. Born in 1752, Simcoe revered the memory of his father, a Royal Navy captain who died in service to the empire during General James Wolfe's conquest of Quebec in 1759. Certain that his father had conceived Wolfe's winning strategy, the son felt driven by a family destiny to lead Canada's development within the empire. Captain Simcoe had drafted 19 maxims to guide his doting son. Ranking love of God first, the captain added, "The love of your country and king, which necessarily flows from the first maxim, must be your ruling principle." And Simcoe was to enforce the social hierarchy by a firm but fair paternalism. Regard the orderly and deserving, punish inexorably the disobedient and flagitious. Educated at Eton College and Oxford University, Simcoe delighted in classical languages and ancient historians, especially Plutarch. A critic later observed, "The governor is a man of some reading and a tolerable classical scholar. For a man of the world, he appears to be governed too much by maxims. To me, it appears that His Excellency has proposed to himself, as a model, one of Plutarch's chieftains. It ought, however, to be recollected that not one of Plutarch's heroes was the governor of a modern British province." At age 18, Simcoe bought an ensign's commission in the British Army and joined the war against the American Revolution. An ambitious and dashing young officer, Simcoe served with distinction in the campaigns of 1776 and 1777 in New York, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania. Promoted to major, he received a daunting new assignment: command of a depleted and disorganized regiment of Loyalists, the Queen's Rangers. Simcoe rebuilt the ranks to 400 men in an innovative corps that combined light infantry with light cavalry. Belying the stereotype of British redcoats as slow and blundering, the Queen's Rangers wore green uniforms and moved rapidly for hit-and-run raids. Employed in scouting and raiding around New York City, the regiment tangled early and often with Patriot militia and light troops. Aggressive, bold, and opportunistic, Simcoe won dozens of skirmishes, inflicting heavy casualties and taking hundreds of prisoners. Impressed by that record, the British commander, General Sir Henry Clinton, promoted Simcoe to lieutenant colonel. Simcoe empathized with his Loyalist troops, who had suffered violent persecution by their Patriot neighbors. He explained, "There are few families among them but what can relate some barbarous murder or atrocious requisition which their relatives have undergone from the rulers of the United States, however those transactions may have been concealed and glossed over in Europe." The patriots, he charged, "fined, whipped, banished, and hung without mercy all who opposed their resolutions." Partisan combat by small units was especially ruthless, doubly so when the combatants were fellow Americans. By taking revenge on the Patriots, Simcoe obeyed his father's maxim to punish the disobedient. Simcoe burned a New Jersey courthouse and jail after finding and liberating a chained and starving loyalist. He also torched a church for hosting snipers and executed a Patriot militia captain accused of atrocities. Governor William Livingston of New Jersey denounced Simcoe as a consummate savage. Wounded and captured in October 1779, he suffered 2 months of close confinement ordered by Livingston, who wanted to hang him. Instead, a parole and exchange restored Simcoe to the British service. As a partisan on the front lines with a Loyalist unit, Simcoe depended upon timely insights about local roads, enemy movements, and secret friends. He cultivated closeted Loyalists who provided crucial tips and insights. Impressed by Simcoe's knack and network, General Clinton engaged him in secret service operations, supervised by Captain John André. In 1780, Simcoe worked on André's boldest gambit, a bid to turn General Benedict Arnold from patriot hero into a Loyalist agent who would betray the fortress at West Point. André's capture by Patriot militia foiled that betrayal, but Arnold escaped to British lines. Unable to recover Arnold, Washington settled for hanging André as a spy. Infuriated, Simcoe ordered his troops to wear mourning and to seek the vengeance due to an injured nation and an insulted army. Instead, the war ended badly for Simcoe and the Loyalists. Sent to Virginia in 1780, Simcoe and most of the Queen's Rangers suffered defeat and surrender as part of Lord Cornwallis's army at Yorktown in 1781. Simcoe escaped captivity when delegated by Cornwallis to take news of the surrender to England. His captured men were less fortunate, with some executed as American deserters. At home, Simcoe fumed at the government's decision to make peace, accept American independence, and abandon the Loyalists. Simcoe also lost his military patron when Clinton resigned, giving up command in America to Sir Guy Carleton. To mend some fences with the Americans, Carleton degraded and disbanded the Queen's Rangers remaining in New York City, which infuriated Simcoe in distant England. After the British evacuated the city in late 1783, the former Queen's Rangers resettled with their families in Nova Scotia and New Brunswick. Meanwhile, Simcoe prospered in England. In 1782, he married a well-educated, artistic, and strong-willed heiress, Elizabeth Posthuma Gwillem. The niece of an admiral and a lord, she provided a 5,000-acre estate in Devonshire, where the couple built a mansion named Wolford Lodge, and they raised 6 children born in the decade following their marriage. In 1790, Simcoe won a seat in Parliament, where he consistently supported the crown. Gregarious and generous, he made many friends. Despite his domestic happiness, material prosperity, and political success, Simcoe remained haunted by the Revolution. A visitor later noted, "The hatred of the governor against the United States occasions him, on the slightest occasion, to overleap all the bounds of prudence and decency, which he carefully observes in all other matters. He was a zealous promoter of the American War, in which he took a very active, yet very unfortunate part. The calamitous issue of the war has still more exasperated his hostility. I listened to his boasting of the numerous houses he had fired during that unfortunate conflict, and of his intention to burn a still greater number in case of a rupture." Simcoe longed for the chance to fight the war again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.